Vishnu Guru Devo Maheshwara Guru Sakshat Parabrahma Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha Akhanda Mandala Akaram Vyaptam Yena Characharam Tatpadam Darshitam Yena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha Hari Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha Hari Om Dhyana Mulam Gurur Murti Puja Mantramulam Gurur Vakyam Mokshamulam Gurur Kripa Om Shanti, Shanti, Shanti Om Sahana Bhavatu Sahanau bhunaktu saha viryam karmavahai tejasvinavadhitamastu ma vidvishavahai om shanti shanti shanti
Jai Gurudev. Welcome everyone to our new Siva Spiritual Center at Chembur. This is the first time we are having our Bhagavad Gita session over here. Welcome to all those on Zoom also who could not be with us over here. We are on the fifth Adhyaay, as you know, and we will start, of course, with the chanting, and after that we'll take the verses one by one. So it's the fifth Adhyaya, fifth chapter.
Vasudeva Sutam Devam Kansa Chanura Mardanam Devaki Paramanandam Krishnam Vande Jagat Guru Om Shri Paramanandam Atha Panchamo Dhyayah Arjuna Uvacha Sanyasam Karmanam Krishna Punaryogam Cha Sansasi Yachreya Etayorekam Tanme Bruhi Sunishchitam Shri Bhagavan Uvacha Sanyasa Karma Yogascha Nishreyasa Karabhubhau Tayostu Karma Sanyasa Karma Yogo Vishishyate Yeyam Sanitya Sanyasi Yo na dreshti na kaṃkṣati nirdvando hi mahābhāho sukham bandhāt pramuchyate sāṅkhya yogo prithak bālā pravadanti na panditāha ekam avyāstita sa samyak ubhayor vindate phalam yat samkhyai prapyate sthanam tat yogairapi gamyate ekam samkhyam cha yogam cha ya pashyati sa pashyati sannyasastu mahabaho dukkham abduma yogatah yoga yukto munir brahma nachirena adigacchati yoga yukto vishuddhatma vijitatma jitendriyah sarva bhutatma bhutatma kurvannapi nalipyate.
Om Tat Sat. We'll stop at Shlok 7. Adhyaay 5, you know, since the time that the two armies, Kauravas and Pandavas, were arrayed on the battlefield, in a little while, when Arjun asked Bhagwan Krishna to take his chariot and bring it to the center of the two armies, suddenly Arjun was in a state of confusion. We all know that, we have been studying. What should he do? Should he fight the war? Or should he renounce the world, take a begging bowl, become a sannyasi, live in the mountains, and just run away from this horrible dilemma in which he finds himself? Now, in the fourth adhyaya, second adhyaya, Bhagwan gave all the possible jnana of Vedanta. Third adhyaya, he gave a little bit more details of karma yoga. Then in the fourth adhyaya, which we finished just studying a few weeks ago, Bhagavan Krishna spoke extensively about renouncing action, meaning sannyas, not doing action. Now if you go to your page of Shlok 33 of the fourth adhyaya, he says all actions culminate in knowledge, means jnana, knowledge is the highest sadhana. All other actions will culminate in knowledge. Again in 37th shloka, he says, the fire of knowledge reduces all actions to ashes. Right? It's there in your book. In other words, what is Bhagwan saying? Bhagwan is seeming to say that renounce your actions and follow the path of knowledge. Because that is what we also understand, and that is what Arjun also understands. But then Bhagwan throws one googly. Because in the last shloka, 42, what is he saying? Slashing to pieces with the sword of knowledge, this doubt in your heart, born of ignorance, establish yourself in karma yoga. All the time he's talking of do knowledge, it will burn to ashes, this, that and the other. Now he's saying establish yourself in karma yoga and stand up for the fight. Right? So, quite understandable. Arjun is confused. Again, first chapter confused. Second chapter after all the jnana confused. Third chapter also confused. Fourth chapter also confused. Now fifth chapter is starting. So the fifth adhyaya starts with what? Which of the two paths is decidedly good or better for me? For me, out of these two paths, path of action or path of renunciation, which is the better one for me? Shall I renounce action or shall I perform action? So here we are also in a dilemma many times. For us also, like Arjun, what shall I do? What shall I follow? Sannyasam or karmanam? Sannyasam means renouncing my actions. And we call it over here karma sannyas. Karma sannyas, renounce karma, renounce action. Action ko tyag karo. Ya, shall I go in for karma naam? Shall I perform my actions? Shall I go in for karma yoga? These two paths often present themselves to us also who are in sansar. What should I do? Shall I take sannyas? Shall I stop? Or shall I do my dharma? Shall I keep doing my work? How long should I do? How much do I have to do? Till when do I have to keep working? Or should I simply retire now? Enough, both ho gaya. So, common question for all of us, all sadhaks. At some stage or the other in your life, you will come to this crossroad. What to do? Which is the best sadhana? Gyan yog or karma yog? So, first shlok, Adhyaay 5, which we just did last time. Arjun once again asks, pray tell me, which of the two is decidedly conducive to my good? And here the operating word is my. Because this is not a general answer you can give to everyone. What is good for my good? Agar kisi ke liye sannyas is good, then for another person, karma is good. So there is not just one answer you can give to everyone, and the correct or the wise person will say, tell me what is good for me. You go to the doctor. Doctor will give you some medicine which is good for you in particular. He will see acidity hota hai, nahi hota hai, do you get fever, have you got an active lifestyle, and do you have a relaxed lifestyle. Based on all these things, some medicine is given to you. Based on all these things, also sadhana is given to you. And that is what people don't get. That sadhana also is a particular prescription given to each person. So, second shlok, what does Bhagavan Krishna tell Arjun? Both the paths are good. There is nothing like one path is good and the other path is not good. Both are good. Both will lead to the supreme bliss. Both will take you to the end goal. But for Arjun, what is better? Path of action. Karma Yoga is better for Arjun. Why? Why is Karma Yoga better for Arjun? Because see where he is in chapter 1. He is in Moha. He is gripped in moha, he is gripped in delusion, he is gripped in not knowing what is right and what is wrong. Jo dharma hai, he is confusing and making it into adharma. And what is adharma, he is making into dharma. So, for him who is so confused, and for all of us who are confused, it is impossible. For those who are confused to understand the subtle teachings of Gyan Yoga. So till the mind is completely clear, completely understanding, completely shant, completely still, there is some stuff to be done. Then only you will be able to understand the subtle teachings of Gyan Yoga. Okay? And until you can understand the subtle teachings of Gyan Yoga, matlab Vedanta, till that time, you will not get the direct experience, which we call a paroksh anubhuti. So that means, till you are confused, path of action or karma yoga has to be practiced. So what is this path of action? What do I have to do? Kya karna padta hai? First, see, for everyone, action is to compulsory. Everybody is doing some action or the other. Karya is natural. Every minute you are doing. In the beginning, for every single person, we have always done an action for a desired result. Otherwise, we would not have done the action. You will not brush your teeth also if you don't have the desired result of having clean teeth or good hygiene. Right? So for every action, we have always had a desired result. We work while we want money. Want or we need, whatever. We eat what we like. We don't eat what we don't like. Because we want to experience the taste which we enjoy for the pleasure. Why do we make friends? Because we are happy with them. They suit our nature. That is why everything we do has to have, will always have a desired result. Even we go to the temple, we pray to God, 99% of the people will pray for a result. Ek bacha de do, give one husband, nice husband, obedient. Give one nice wife, give a business, whatever. Is it true or not? We pray to God also for a particular desired result. This is the first level of action. Praying, working, doing anything for a particular desired result. Then, one fine day, through the grace of God, you attend satsang. You know, it's a grace of God to attend satsang, even on Zoom. So, when you come to satsang, you understand that there are other reasons also for doing action. Then you feel inspired, you feel motivated. Koi seva kar lo. Do some voluntary work. Don't only work for your own result, for your own benefit. You can also work for somebody else's benefit. Voluntary work, seva work. So many of you go and do seva work in cancer hospital. You do seva work in Siva. You do so much. So you have at least understood that you can do some action which is not selfish, but for the benefit of others. Then more satsang will tell you ki when you do seva for other people, there also ahankar should not come. There also ego should not come. Ki main itna karti hoon, main itna karta hoon. I do so much voluntary work. I put my name also on the board over there, donated by X, Y, and Z. वो कुर्सी भी कुर्सी के नाम पे भी कुर्सी के ऊपर भी नाम जाता है बोर्ड के ऊपर यू पुट अ नेम सो देन यू नो थ्रू सत्संग आई कैन डू सेवा फॉर अदर पीपल्स बेनिफिट विदाउट कर्ता भाव एंड विदाउट भोक्ता भाव दैट कम्स द थर्ड लेवल ऑफ एक्शन एंड व्हेन यू डू इट लाइक दैट यू हैव एंटर्ड कर्म योग. So from ekdam personal selfish desire, you have gone to voluntary work for the benefit of others, and after benefit of others, you are also doing that benefit to others without ahankar, without karta bhav, without bhokta bhav. Then you start seeing some good results because laundry service has started within you. Some cleansing, some purifying automatically starts happening. Then deep cleaning has to happen. You know, when we started this new center, first we cleaned upar se, it is not clean enough. Then you have to do deep cleaning, scrubbing, polishing. So somehow deep cleaning has to be done inside. So in the third shloka, Bhagwan tells Arjun, get rid of three obstacles in your antakaran. You remember what they are? Both time ho gaya na? Three obstacles. Dvesh. Vasanas. Desires. And dvandva. Means always opposites. Always living in the opposites. Good, bad, up, down, high, low. Means continuously judging things. So you have to get rid of three things. Hatred. Dvesh, vasna, desires, and dvandha, opposites, polarities. Why? Why have to get rid of all these things? Why can't I have dvandha? Why can't I have, desires? What's wrong with that? So that's where satsang tells you what is your goal. What is your lakshya in life? What is your goal? Your goal is liberation. Your goal is your highest spiritual potential. That is what you need. And for that, knowledge of Vedas has to be learned. Knowledge of Vedas has to be understood. And to understand that knowledge, all obstacles have to be removed. And the obstacles are these three. What are these three? Dvesh, Vasna, Dvandva. These three obstacles have to be removed. When these obstacles are removed, Buddhi becomes clean. When Buddhi becomes clean, its job starts getting done. What is the job of Buddhi? Vivek. Vivek. Clarity of understanding. What is correct? What is not correct? What is dharma? What is adharma? What is sat? What is asat? Jab ye teen obstacles nikal jate hain, then Vivek starts working. When Vivek starts working and you know what is sat and asat, you will obviously go towards sat. Why would you go towards asat? So vairagya towards asat starts happening. If you have Vivek, you will not go towards asat. You will go towards sat. And when you go towards sat, asat will drop. When asat drops, we call that vairagya. All the actions that are taking you away from your goal will automatically drop. You will not have to do anything. Now, maybe you have to force yourself, I should not go to nightclub. I should not eat meat. Or I should not go to the bar and have a drink. You have to force yourself because you say, this is not correct. Vedas are not allowing us to do all this. But when it comes through Vivek and Vairagya, all these actions will automatically drop. You will not have to do any effort for that. It will automatically happen. And when that happens, all the actions which are taking us away from our goal drop. Then which way will you be going? Towards your goal. If you are not going away from your goal, there is only one other way, and that is towards the goal. You'll go towards your goal in that stillness. You'll contemplate on the divine, and when you contemplate on the divine in shanti, in stillness, you will achieve your goal. That goal is what? A paroksh anubhuti. So this is how the actions start evolving from a completely personal, selfish, desire-motivated action to that place where you will reach your highest spiritual potential. And that is why Bhagwan says both paths are useful. Both will take you. Karma Yoga will also take you. Gyan Yoga will also take you to your highest goal. This is where we stopped last time on shloka number 3. Let's go to shloka number 4. We'll chant it once. I will say half the line and then you all will repeat it after me. Sankhya Yoga Prithak Bala.
Sankhya Yoga Prithak Bala.
Pravadanti na Pandita.
Pravadanti na Pandita.
Ekamapyasthita Samyag.
Ekamapyasthita Samyag.
Ubhayorvindate Phalam.
Ubhayorvindate Phalam.
Let's chant it together, the full thing.
Sankhya Yoga Prithak Bala. Pravadanti na panditah, ekam apyasita samyak, ubhayo vindate phalam.
Bhagwan is telling Arjun, it is the ignorant, not the wise, who say that Sankhya Yoga and karma yoga lead to divergent results. For one who is firmly established in either, gets the fruit of both, which is the same, and that is God realization. Okay, let's go to the meanings of the words first, and then we will discuss the shloka. Bala. Bala, you know, means child, right? Bacha. But here it means people with immature buddhi. Those whose buddhi is childlike. That means spiritually ignorant. Na panditaha, not the wise. Balaha, not panditaha. Children, immature people, not the wise people. Pravadanti, speak of. What do they speak of? Sankhya Yoga. They speak of path of knowledge and path of action. In this one word, Sankhya Yoga, he has put both the paths together. Sankhya standing for knowledge and yoga standing for karma. So both the paths. Children or people with immature buddhi, not the wise, they speak of path of knowledge and path of action, prithaka, as different. Meaning they think that both these paths have opposite results, different results. Samyak means actually properly. What is not written there is if someone you can put in brackets, then you'll get the syntax. But by itself it means properly. Asthitaha follows. So if someone properly follows ekamapi, even one path, anyone, vindate, one gets, what does he get? Phalam, result, fruit of the action. Ubhayo, of both. So let's see, Bhagwan, who does Bhagwan call Bala? Kaun hai Bala? Who is this person of immature spiritual buddhi or understanding? Means Balak buddhi, childlike, not an expert in spirituality. Someone who is newly introduced to spirituality, novice in spirituality. They claim that just take sannyas, just renounce the world, chhod do sab, you will reach moksha. They believe like that. Kuch bhi karo, chhod do, aisa maa se kapda le lo and put one tikka, and then nothing more you have to do, only you have to renounce the world like that, okay? You will get the highest goal. Possible? No balas over here, that means. See, these people, they don't get the information correctly. Maybe they don't go to the Vedas themselves, or maybe they don't go to the satsang, they don't go to guru. Internet mein padh liya kuch, and you know, on internet anyone can put anything. There is no one to tell you ki this is correct information or not correct information. They will read, chalo, come on, take sannyas. People now have started giving sannyas by email also. People have started giving diksha by email, by like, okay, all those who want to take diksha will log on this particular day at this particular time. Somewhere somebody is giving diksha to 2000 people. And what will happen now? That's all. You have renounced. You will get moksha. This is called Bala Buddhi. Okay, immature. but not the wise, na pandita. Pandita, the wise people don't think like that. They know, what do they know? They know that there are different stages to be crossed in spirituality. Before you reach your final destination, before you reach moksha, there are so many stages that will come. The common goal is there. Lakshya ek hi hai. Goal is only one. But there are different stages, different steps, and they have to be advised to different people according to their gunas, according to their acumen. Alright? So the wise ones are the ones who have practiced Shravan, they have done Manan, they have done Nididhyasan, they are doing all the sadhanas that have been recommended. Don't miss that word recommended. No manmani. Only what is recommended you do. Don't try to take it into your own hands. Aisa bhi karna chahiye, aisa bhi karna chahiye. When they do that, Bhagwan is saying both the paths, action ka path and tyag, renunciation, both will have different sadhanas. Sadhanas will be different. Naturally, sadhanas have to be different. But the goal to be reached for both is one and the same. For example, if there's a train, the first bogie in the train will also go to Delhi only, and the last bogie of the train will also go to Delhi only. Both the first and the last compartments are going to the same station. They are not going to some different station. It doesn't matter if you are in the first bogie or the second bogie or the 10th bogie. But you have to go where your ticket has been reserved. Your ticket is reserved according to your ability to pay for that bogie, right? So, this is the first point he's saying. Difference between Bala and Pandita. Now, if anyone, Samyak, masters the sadhanas at each stage. Each stage, if the guru is giving you some sadhana, make it perfect. Practice it. Do abhyas. Master that. Be well established at each stage. Jab karna hai to do it perfectly. Puja karna hai to do it perfectly. Dhyan karna hai to do it perfectly. At each stage, become the master, become, then automatically next stage will be easy for you to do. In sadhana panchakam, you remember we did evening satsang sadhana panchakam, there were 40 sadhanas, and Bhagwan Adi Shankaracharya clearly told us it's like a ladder, sopan panchakam. So if you go on one step, be firmly established there, don't suddenly jump because you like the fifth sadhana better. So forget 1, 2, 3, 4, go directly to fifth. If you do that, if your foot is not well established, it may slip, and where will you fall? All the way down. So if you remove your foot from the ladder, there's a chance that aage you will not be able to continue your journey. So in our sadhanas also, every sadhana has been given to you for a purpose, to master a particular level of your ability. If you don't have that ability, it's no point going on and on to the next one. So what has the Shastras told us? Start with Karma Yoga. Start with Karma Yoga. Don't only start with Karma Yoga, perfect the Karma Yoga. Master the Karma Yoga. Then only your antakaran will get shuddhi. Your antakaran, your mind, will get cleansed, purified. And in that, automatically, those three obstacles will go away. Remember them? Hatred, desire, dvandh. Wo apne aap chale jayega. But without karma yoga, it cannot go. That is why people get stuck in the journey, because they are trying to go directly like Arjuna, in the mountain as a sannyasi, where they have not removed so many of the six enemies that we all have in our antakaran. So sometimes, you know, it happens here also in Siva. You come to satsang, then you learn something, then you go home and you try to thapko that knowledge onto somebody else. You know what Ma said? You have to do like this, you have to do like that. But you have to do, no. You don't have to tell your children, you don't have to tell your mother-in-law, you don't have to tell your father-in-law. It is for you, because you have reached that stage where Arjun has been given this information. While I love it, you know, because what you all do, you all have one gun, rifle. And that rifle, na, you put on my shoulder. You put the rifle on my shoulder and from the back you shoot somebody. Ki ma ne kaha hai. Ma ne kaha hai. And still they don't listen. I will tell ma, you are doing like this. So this is not meant for your mother-in-law, father-in-law, all your in-laws and outlaws. It is meant for you, because you have done chapter 1, 2, 3 and 4. Now you are on 5. They have not done. So no point in giving this gyan to other people. This also people do. They take diksha. Or they learn some new program, something. Then they love it. They love it and then they start talking about this, so nice, you should also take. Are why you should take? Because you will have fun, you will this. Now, you know, I learned one, I also learned a lot from y'all. I learned FOMO.
Yes.
FOMO. Fear of missing out. Now that poor girl going in the carpool with three Diksha students, they are all discussing, Diksha, this. She said, I'm the only one who doesn't have, I should also have Diksha. Not, that no idea what is that of FOMO. Like this, what sadhanas are given to you, they are given to you for a purpose, because they are meant for you at that stage. So I always tell people two things. One, never force anyone to come for satsang. If you can inspire, you can suggest, but just because you love it doesn't mean others will also love it. Let them come if they want to come. Let them experience it. If they like it, they will come themselves, but don't force. And second, what was the second thing? I forgot. One is don't force, and the other is don't talk about your sadhanas to anyone. Sadhana is your personal connection with your guru. It is between you and your guru. You are not supposed to talk about your sadhana to anyone else. Hum aisa karta hai, jap karta hai, this is my mantra, this so many malas I do, this I do, that I do. No, there's nobody's business what you do. You do what your guru has told you, that's it. Okay? So, let's take this now to Arjun. Arjun wanted to run away from battle. He wanted to take sannyas. Was he ready? Was that the sadhana meant for him at that time? Absolutely not. That was not at all the sadhana. Was he ready to be a sannyasi? A kshatriya prince, a warrior, courageous, fighting wars, winning wars. Was he ready to take sannyas? Definitely not. So therefore, he's having still got that moha in him. What will happen to the women? What will happen to the children? What will happen to my family? What will happen to the name of my family? Now, this thing, that thing, whatever. This confusion. Also, he is not doing his dharma of kshatriya. Therefore, Bhagwan says, Babu, this is not the time for you to take sannyas. Right now, the path which is the best for you is karma yoga, path of action. This is what you have to do. Now, you know very well, path of karma yoga. Two most important points are there, right? What are they? No karta bhav, no bhokta bhav. No karta bhav means no doership. No, I have done, I have done. No bhokta bhav means no expectation of a particular outcome. Which is easier? Which is easier? No karta bhav or no bhokta bhav? I ask you. No karta bhav is easier? No bhokta bhav is much easier. Because you can make yourself understand, theek hai, ho jayega, I'm doing this project. If it is good, it will happen. If it's not good, theek hai, I tried my best. It is easier for you to give up bhokta bhav. Right or wrong? For no bhokta bhav to be given up, you need karma yoga knowledge. And for no karta bhav, very difficult. I am giving satsang here. Who says I am not giving? I am sitting here. It's very difficult for a person to understand that I am not doing it. If I am not doing, who is doing? It's very difficult to use no karta bhav. You have cooked for 5 hours one nice big dinner and you say, nahin, maine toh kuch nahin kiya. I am not the doer. It's difficult. I have only done. You are slaving over your family, picking up what? Glasses and socks. Then you are saying, I no karta bhav. I am not doing. That is why it is so difficult for you to give up that expectation, right or wrong. Therefore, karta bhav requires, giving up karta bhav requires deep knowledge of jnana yoga. And much more difficult to give up karta bhav than bhokta bhav. Easier to give up the anxiety of the result of the action than to give up the fact that I am not doing. If I am not doing, who is doing? I only did na, dekho pasina itna. I am only doing. That is why it is so difficult. When you all say, I am doing for my family so much, I did this, I did that, and there is no appreciation from them. What is that? No appreciation for who? It is full karta bhav only, no? So it is very difficult to accept, I am not doing. It is very difficult to accept, I am not the doer. And for that, jnana is required. Deep understanding of jnana yoga. And that comes later. Easier to understand no bhokta bhav through karma yoga. And later, no karta bhav from jnana yoga. But don't misunderstand that whether you are on path of yoga, means karma yoga, or you are on the path of jnana yoga, knowledge, finally karta bhav and bhokta bhav both have to be renounced. Both will have to be renounced. But first, you will be able to renounce bhokta bhav before you will be able to renounce karta bhav. But we want that bliss right away. We want that bliss. People say, renounce everything. You will experience supreme bliss. You will feel so happy. Sannyas le lo. Sannyas le lo. You will feel so happy. So there is one story. You know, Vedant, these our rishis and our gurus, they have such amusing stories which really hit the point. So I'll tell you that story. So there was one shop, maybe like food spot, you know. One snack shop was there, very famous for pani puri. Huh? So the advertisement they said is, eat our pani puri, you will reach swarg. You know, it's like so supreme bliss in that pani puri. So this guy said, wow, you know, so good pani puri, I will also go and have. So he asked, ek pani puri de do, give me one pani puri. He ate it. Where is the bliss? I'm not feeling that supreme bliss. Aur ek de do. Nothing. Five pani puris. Nothing is happening. What is why am I not feeling anything? 6, 7, 8, 15 pani puris. He felt, tripped. Really nice. This pani puri is really good. So 15th pani puri, he felt very happy because he was full. All his vikshep was settled down. His attention went to the stomach rather than the vikshep in his mind. So he said, 15 pani puri khaya, 15 pani puris I've eaten. That gives supreme bliss. So next day he went to the shop and he said, please give me the 15th pani puri. Can you have the 15th pani puri before the first 14th pani puris? Only after the 14th pani puris, the 15th pani puri will give you that bliss. So what we want the bliss of the 15th pani puri. We want the bliss of knowledge before doing the 1 to 14 points of karma yoga. Possible? Can you get 15th pani puri ka bliss without 14 first pani puris? Maybe you can get fifth, by the 5th or the 6th, but for this guy it took 15. Alright, so impossible, impossible to get that moksh or aparoksh anubhuti or that anand or whatever you want to call it without doing the preliminary work of preparing your mind, preparing your antakaran, cleaning it out and making it ready for that bliss to be experienced. That is why Bhagwan says in this shloka, once again we'll read it, it is the ignorant bala, not the wise, na pandita, who will say that Sankhya Yoga and Karma Yoga lead to divergent results. Prithak, they are different. For one who is firmly established in either, they get the fruit of both, which is the same, Karma Yoga and Jnana Yoga. The final goal is God realization. Okay? Clear? This shloka is clear? Okay, let's go on to the shloka number 5. We'll read it half and then together again. Shloka 5.
Yat Sankhya Prapyate Sthanam.
Yat Sankhya Prapyate Sthanam.
Tadyogairapi Gamyate.
Tadyogairapi Gamyate.
Ekam Sankhyam Cha Yogam Cha.
Ekam Sankhyam Cha Yogam Cha.
Yapashyati Sapashyati.
Yapashyati Sapashyati.
All together.
Sankhya Prapyate Sthanam.
Yat Sankhya Prapyate Sthanam. Tad Yogairapi Gamyate. Ekam Sankhyam Cha Yogam Cha. Yapashyati Sapashyati.
The supreme state which is reached by the Sankhya Yogi is attained also by the Karma Yogi. Therefore, he alone who sees Sankhya Yoga and Karma Yoga as identical, as far as the result goes, sees truly. Meanings, sthanam, destination. What is that destination? State of liberation, moksha. Yat prapyate, that is reached. The destination that is reached, sankhyai, by those sons established in knowledge, those who are doing jnana yoga, jo jnana yoga ke path pe hai, that's destination. prapyate, that state is reached. Tat prapyate, that state is reached. Api, also yogai, by the yogis, meaning karma yogis. The state of liberation which is reached by the those on the path of Gyan Yoga are also reached by the those on the path of Karma Yoga. So, he Pashyati truly sees Yaha, who Pashyati truly sees, again, Sankhyam, no, Sankhya, knowledge, Cha, and Yogam, Karma Yog, Ekam, as one. If we were to rephrase the whole thing, that state, that destination, that goal that is reached by those sons who are established in knowledge is also reached by those who are practicing Karma Yoga. The one who truly sees, means the one who has real knowledge, is the one who sees Sankhya and Yoga as one and the same. Sthanam, place, last destination, last station where you want to go, liberation, realization, aparoksh anubhuti. That's the meaning of this word sthanam here. Sankhyai, Sankhyai meaning those sons established in knowledge, through the path of knowledge, through Gyan Yoga. Yogai, by the yogis who are following Karma Yoga. They both have the same destination in mind. Whether you are doing Karma Yoga or whether you are doing Gyan Yoga, you have the same destination. There are no separate destinations then. The ones who are doing Karma Yoga are doing Karma Yoga to be able to reach the path of knowledge. They are doing the cleaning work, purification work, so that they can understand the subtle teachings of Gyan Yoga easily. How are they doing this? By doing the actions, as you know, without Karta Bhav, without Bhokta Bhav, and very importantly, dedicating their actions to Bhagwan. So now, Bhagwan says, the goal of both is ekam, one and the same. Sthan you are going to reach is the same. Then, why do seekers see a difference in these two? Why is it that people have arguments, no, Karma Yoga is better, no, Gyan Yoga is better, and this is higher, and this is lower, and this is better, and this is not better? Why would Bhagwan Krishna tell Arjun one is superior to the other, or why would Bhagwan Krishna recommend one to the other? Both are the same. Why is it being considered as superior for Arjun? And this is also Arjun's question also. Which of the two is better for me, highest in my interest? So the word here is Pashyati. Pashyati. What is the Pashyati means to see. What are we seeing wrongly? What are we understanding wrongly? What are we realizing wrongly to think that one is better than the other? Why are we seeing Gyan Yoga higher than Karma Yoga? Because generally people will say, nah, Gyan Yoga is better. That is because it will burn all actions to ashes. It will take you across the ocean of ignorance. So many things we have learned about Gyan. So we think Gyan is the higher thing. So Something we are pashyati wrong. Something we are seeing wrongly. What is that? First, the final results are the same. Yet, we see, have a false impression, we perceive wrongly, that getting more and more knowledge, getting more and more information, data, learning more and more shastras is advanced sadhana. And therefore, we should focus on getting more shastra, more knowledge, more courses, more gyan. But what they don't pashtati, what they don't see, is the advanced shastras, or in inverted commas, advanced shastras don't tell you anything more. What more can they tell? There is only one truth. There is only one truth, which is already here. It's already here. What advanced truth can they be giving? So what is that advantage? Therefore, no, go for Gyan Yoga. Forget about Karma Yoga is, for Bala. But they don't realize that they are the Bala. Their understanding is not yet mature. So that more and more theoretical knowledge is required. That is the wrong Pashyati. But what Bhagavan says is, the one who sees both as Eka, same, he truly sees. He truly understands. Okay? When you see that your race to just get more and more information without the purification process, is retarding your spiritual progress, then you will truly see that your unnecessary running for more information is not required. Then you will know that Karma Yoga is as important as Gyan Yoga. Second point. Why is it that people are not giving that much importance to Karma Yoga? Karma Yoga is for what? Purifying. Your antakaran. Now this is very funny. Because it is very easy for people to see others as impure. Iske man mein dvesh hai. Iske man mein ahankar hai. This fellow has this thing. This fellow has this problem. This fellow has... I don't have. I don't need purification. I am to already purified. It's a blind spot. It's possible. It's possible you have done all the cleansing. So then you can easily go. But till that time, it is always easier to see the impurity in others than to see the impurity in yourself. So your own antakaran is your blind spot. You don't see that you actually do need Karma Yoga. You still need a lot of purification process before you can go on to Gyan Yoga. Okay? So Bhagavan is recommending. He's not saying don't renounce actions. He's not saying sannyas is a bad thing. He's not saying Gyan Yoga is a bad thing. He's not saying knowledge is a bad thing. What he's saying is sannyas with knowledge. After you have got the knowledge, after the purification process, you have got the knowledge, then you have renounced actions, that is recommended. So you do the purification, become clean, understand the knowledge, then renounce, perfect sequence. And that sequence is what Bhagavan calls Sankhya. That is Sankhya. Purification, cleanliness, cleaning, everything happened. Knowledge understood. Understood, then you renounce action. Sankhya. Okay? If you don't purify, if you do not clear so many things, kaam, krodh, lobh, moh, mad, matsarya, if that is not clear, tell me, is it possible to sit in meditation and experience Bhagwan? It is not possible. So why waste that time? So if you are just trying to see that Bhagwan when there is a big obstacle in the way, it's a waste of not only your time but also your energy. That time and that energy you put into your self-purification. Then you put that into self-purification and that aparoksh anubhuti will just come by itself. You will not have to work for it. You will not have to strive and you know just force yourself to do something. Okay? Clear up to here? Let's go ahead. Number 6.
Sanyasastu Mahabaho.
Sanyasastu Mahabaho.
Dukkhamaptu Mayogatah.
Dukkhamaptu Mayogatah.
Yoga Yukto Munir Brahma.
Yoga Yukto Munir Brahma.
Nachirenadi Gacchati.
Altogether.
Sanyasastu Mahabaho. Dukkhamaptu Mayogatah. Yoga Yukto Munir Brahma. Nachirenadi Gacchati.
Without Karma Yoga, however, Sankhya Yoga, that is renunciation of doership in relation to all activities of the mind, senses and body is difficult to accomplish. Clear. Difficult to accomplish. Whereas the karma yogi who keeps his mind fixed on God reaches Brahma in no time, Arjun. In no time. I mean, how much more clearly should Bhagwan be telling you what to do? Let's state the words. Tu, but. Sannyasa, renunciation, means proper renunciation, true renunciation, not just giving up like that for the sake of giving up. Dukkhamaptum is hard to attain. It's difficult. It's hard. Why is it hard? Ayogata, without karma yoga. Without karma yoga, renunciation, sannyasa is hard to attain. Mahabaho, Arjun. Muniha, the one who meditates on Bhagwan, Muniha, Yoga Yukto, the one who has mastered Karma Yoga. Adhi Gacchati, attains, reaches. Brahma, Moksha, Brahma. Nachirena, without delay. Mahabaho. Mahabaho is a name that Arjun is getting from Bhagwan. You know, Bhagwan has many, many names which he uses for Arjun. Whenever he wants to give some teaching, no, some particular teaching, whether he is trying to be tongue-in-cheek or whether he is trying to be, you know, clever, he finds the correct name for Arjun. So Mahabaho means mighty armed one. Arjun is very strong. Arjun is very courageous. He is a Kshatriya warrior. He has got a lot of strength. He has beaten so many enemies. He has won so many wars. So he thinks he is very strong. Mahabaho, you are very strong. You have won so many things, you have got lot of muscles, lot of archery, power, this thing, that thing. You think you are so strong that you will be able to take tyag, You will be able to renounce the whole world and live with a begging bowl, which is what he said in first Adhyaay. I'll stay with a begging bowl. You are so strong, you think you can do that? Mahabaho. So little bit of sarcasm over here to Arjun, just to make him understand that don't think you're so strong. Itna tu nahi kar sakega. Without karma yoga, you cannot just suddenly... And where is thinking of taking sannyas? Have you remembered? He is in the battlefield. He is 1 minute away from the war. And he is thinking ki now, abhi ek second mein main bhagunga yahan se, I'll take sannyas and I'll be successful. He says, Mahabaho, you may be very good at fighting your war and killing the rakshas, but this rakshas which is inside you, your moha, your rakshas which is inside you, your confusion which is inside you, are you so mahabaho that you can kill it, you can succeed it? So that is the reason why he has used mahabaho here. See how one word Krishna is using in the correct spot. He's not saying, you know, what he uses, Kunti, Sun and all, he'll not say like that. Here, mahabaho. He says renunciation is a difficult concept. Don't take it so lightly. It's not easy first and foremost to understand what is renunciation. It is not just ki ye kapda pehna, kuch bol haath mein pakda, and you go and you walk and live in one gufa somewhere, one cave. You have not understood what is renunciation. You have to first understand. Then you have to be ready. You have to practice. Then only you will be able to do renunciation, okay? So we said there are two things we have to get rid of, right? Doership, karta bhav, and enjoyership or bhokta bhav. So what has Arjun achieved by now? Has he achieved bhokta bhav? Do you think he's achieved bhokta bhav? Maybe he's okay, I don't care if I win the war or not. Maybe in some way he is not concerned with the fruit of the action. But has he achieved karta bhav? Why do you say no? Why do you say he has not achieved karta bhav yet?
Renouncement of
karta bhav. Why? Yes. You see, does he have karta bhav still?
Yes.
Yes. Yes. You see, I'm fighting my children, my mother, my women folk, my country, my. My goodness, you cannot have so much my without I. So karta bhav is still extremely strong in Arjun. Therefore, he is not yet ready for which yoga? Gyan yoga. When you have got still lot of karta bhav, you are not ready for gyan yoga. You still have to do more karma purification, then that karta bhav will slowly go. That is why he used the word Dukkham aptama. Is hard to attain. Without karta bhav, without karma yoga, sannyas, difficult to attain. Why is it so difficult? Four reasons Bhagavan is giving. Four reasons. Firstly, people have not understood what is renunciation, what is sannyas, what is tyag. For them, or for most of us, for most people, sannyas means giving up things of the world. It means giving up objects, giving up family, giving up business, giving up home, giving up clothes, giving up golden dragon. You know why I say golden dragon? Because yesterday we talked a lot about golden dragon. So true renunciation is not about giving up objects of the world. If true renunciation is not giving up objects of the world, then what is it? It is about giving up the inner obstacles of the mind. People give up chai. People give up coffee. People give up processed food. But what about calm? Can you give up calm? Can you give up krodh? Have you given up lobh? Moh? Mad? Matsarya? Rag? Dvesh? Ahankar? If you have given up those, you are a sannyasi. Not if you have given up chai, coffee and processed food. Okay. So we have not understood. That is why it is difficult to take sannyas. Because you get so scared. Oh my God. If I take sannyas, then will I be able to drink tea? Without tea, I cannot live in the morning. I cannot wake up. I better not take sannyas. What about water? You know, all the things. So basically, you have renunciation means bringing down your desires, increasing your vairagya, reducing your asakti, attachments, increasing your anasakti, detachment. Reducing your ahankar, increasing your anahankar. So sannyas is not about giving up only. It's about developing some good qualities also inside you, right? It's just the opposite. If there are many desires in my mind, can I sit in contemplation? Impossible. Because when you close your eyes and you'll sit like this, bahar ka to sab band ho gaya. Everything is closed outside. All the volcanic lava will start erupting from inside. All the desires, all the vikshep, all the worries, everything from inside will start. So just renouncing vishais, objects of the world, is not enough. You have to renounce all the objects of the world, but be able to establish your mind on Bhagwan. Then there is ability to sit in contemplation. So sons give this example. They say if there is a robber, thief, he has pravritti of robbing things. He is a thief, that's what he does. In his mind there is the thing that I will rob and get something. If you put him in jail, he'll have nothing to rob, right? But the seed of robbing is still there in his mind. You have not removed that seed of vasana, of robbing. Therefore, the minute he will go out, he will again start the same thing, because he has not renounced robbing, he has not renounced stealing, just because he has been put inside one jail. Clear? So renounce the inner is real sannyas, not just renouncing the outer. This is the first reason why sannyas is difficult for people to do. Then people say, I believe in Nirakar Bhagwan. I don't need to do puja. I don't need to do bhakti. I don't need this. I don't need that. I don't do. I renounce it. But can you renounce something that you never do? You are not doing it. Then how do you say I'm renouncing it? Unless you are doing something, how can you say I'm giving up doing it? So you have never done your nitya karma, you are not doing your dharma, now you say I will become sannyasi, I will not do anything. But first you have to do. Only after you do, you can stop doing. Isn't it? Okay? So, go down, meet one bhikari down, one beggar, poor man. You talk to him for 5 minutes, you know, about Vedant, Vivek, Vairagya, Shat Sampatti, you know. He's very impressed. Chalo, aaj se main renounce karunga. I am going to renounce everything. I believe what you say. Ek to uske pocket mein do kauri nahi hai. So he is going to renounce the world. When he has nothing, what he is going to renounce? So therefore, first you do your dharma, then think of renouncing dharma. Because part of that is taking sannyas is not having to do nitya karma. So first you do nitya karma, then you'll be able to renounce nitya karma at the right time. Third, I am so fed up of the world. Everything I try to do fails. Ye project kiya, no success. Tried to get married to this girl, she also ran away. Tried to find a house, somebody else took it. Tried to do this, I'm frustrated. Let me take sannyas. Frustration is not a reason for taking sannyas. Kantala sing sannyas matlo. That is not the meaning of sannyas, my dear. You'll go and stay in a cave, that frustration will come there also. What? This cave is not proper. The roof of the cave is too low. This side, always like that. My caves are also wrong. This mountain is not got enough fruit trees. So kantala. That is another reason why people don't want to take sannyas. But this is not the reason to take sannyas also. They've not understood the meaning of sannyas. And then the most difficult one, mamatvam. Of course, we all have a sense of I am so and so, whatever. But along with that I, we also have a very strong sense of my house, my car, my husband, my child, my wife, my business, my money, my potli, my trunk, my bed, my pillow, my cup, my spoon. We have all those. Mice. We love to possess things. We like to hoard things. Yes or no?
Yes.
This bag, that bag, this shoe. 2 shoes, not enough. You need at least 15. I don't know how you all have place also to keep so many shoes. You all get angry with me when I wear the same slipper, half torn slipper. Somebody saw me at a function. I was wearing the same slipper, whatever I wear. She sent me 2 slippers. Please tell Ma to change her slipper. Because I had that one slipper, I'm wearing it. She sent me 2 slippers, which I had to send back because they were not the correct size. Our sense of value comes from how much we own. Our sense of value comes from how much we possess. Kitna hai hamare paas? Bank balance kitna hai? Share certificate kitna hai? Fixed deposit mein kitna hai? Cupboard ke andar kitna hai? Palak ke niche kitna hai? Wall ke andar kitna bhara hua hai? Garage mein kitna rakha hai? Godown mein kitna rakha hai? How much have we collected, hoarded, possessed? I'm successful. I have value. I have worth. This is mamatva. And of course, linked to aham. Because if there is no I, there can not be any
my.
Or there is no, yeah, same thing. My, I and my, they go together. You have to renounce both, I also and my also. Why is it difficult to renounce? Why is it it difficult to renounce?
Because we identify with this body.
Correct. It is our identification with our body, mind, intellect, BMI. I am this body, I am this mind, I am this intellect, I am who I think I am, this false notion of I, and that false notion you have identified with so strongly, it will not allow you to renounce. Try telling somebody to give up his possessions. Very difficult. That is why Bhagavan calls it what? Dukkham aptam. Very dukhi. It will make a person very dukhi. Tell somebody, aapka savings nikal do. Aapka kapda nikal do. Kapda nikal do. Aapka... You get rid of your possessions. If you say that, it will make someone very, very dukhi. They will not be able to do it. Because of this strong identification with aham, which has given you mamatva. Okay? So let's recap the four difficulties, because this is important. It's not important because I'm going to tell you to take sannyas. It's important because you need to progress on your path. So you need to know what is coming in the way. First, you're trying to renounce without working on the vasanas in your mind. That is the first thing. You're trying to renounce an action that you don't do anyway. You are not doing puja, you say, I will renounce puja. I don't believe in it. But first you at least try, at least believe. Then you can renounce. You're trying to renounce just because your dreams, your wish list, your bucket list is not getting fulfilled. Kantala, frustration. That's not a reason to renounce. And you have not worked on your sense of my. Bhagavan says, if you want to overcome these four difficulties, do what? Karma Yoga. Again and again, coming back to the same thing Bhagavan is trying to tell you in different ways. Karma Yoga will polish the mind. It will give you the correct way to get rid of the impurities. Now, many years ago, when we were doing Bhagavad Gita in Mukunda and Sampada's house, we were all sitting and I had brought some silverware. You remember? Yeah. I got three articles which I allowed to get black with whatever oxidization. I put three people with equal black silverware and I gave one person soap. I gave one person, I think, Vim, and one person I gave Ruperi. Ruperi immediately cleans the silver, like Colgate tooth powder. The one who is trying to remove the black silver thing with soap will just be wasting his time. Nothing will come out. It will, you know, silver doesn't get clean with soap. The one who is doing with Vim will have to scrub pretty hard. But the one with Ruperi, just one drop and the thing becomes sparkling silver in one shot. Therefore, if you want to remove the impurities in your mind, you need the right technique. You need the right cleaning agent. And that cleaning agent is Karma Yoga. Now, how long will I have to do? That's the first question anyone asks, you know. They want mantra, they want some upai, something. How long will I have to do it? How long, how black has your silverware become? That long you have to scrub it. Understand? When you do it the right way, it will get done quicker. If you don't do it the right way, it will take longer. So Bhagavan says, do it the right way. Nachirena, it will be cleaned without delay. Nachirena, without delay. Fatafat, you will clean it in one shot. Who is telling you this? Bhagwan. Not me. This Bhagwan's guarantee. Huh? You sell a product. Will you give a guarantee like that? In 1 second it will go. Bhagwan is giving that guarantee. Huh? And not only Bhagwan's guarantee, you try it out. I have tried it out. It is proven that you do karma yoga correctly, your impurities will go away, nachirena, without delay. So Bhagavan says the wise have tested this technique. The wise have tested this technique. Who are the wise? Bhagavan gives you two words there. Who are they? Yoga yukta. The one who has perfected the technique of karma yoga. The one who has mastered karma yoga. He has performed actions in the world. He has also performed his puja, rites, rituals in bhakti with the right technique of no karta bhav, no bhokta bhav, etc., etc., etc. And he has found that doing all these actions without expecting any particular result, without karta bhav, fully dedicating to Bhagwan has purified his antakaran. Yoga yukta. Who else? Anyone else has done this? Any other? Muni. The one who is meditating on that supreme being. Muni. From where you get the word manan? Contemplation. The muni who does manan. He also, after practicing karma yoga, cleansing his antakaran, has now practiced Gyan Yoga. He is sitting in Manan. He also guarantees, he also proves that this technique works. What about the Karma Yogi? Is he also a Muni? Yes, because he is also thinking before doing an action. Am I doing in Karta Bhav? Am I doing this action in Bhokta Bhav? Am I dedicating my actions to Bhagwan? Is this my Swadharma? Am I doing it 100%? He is also doing Manan. So when you do your actions like this, the Munihi and the Yoga Yukta, both of them are saying, do it! And you will get purified. Once you get purified, Gyan will just come very easily to you. Okay? That's basically what this verse is telling you. Both Yoga Yukta and Munihi have reached Brahmahood through this method. Clear? Any doubt about this? Let's go to one last shloka, number 7. Yoga Yukto Vishuddhatma.
Yoga Yukto Vishuddhatma.
Vijitatma Jitendriya.
Vijitatma Jitendriya.
Sarva Bhutatma Bhutatma.
Sarva Bhutatma Bhutatma.
Kurvannapi na lipyate.
Kurvannapi na lipyate.
All together.
Yoga Yukto Vishuddhatma. Vijitatma Jitendriya. Sarva Bhutatma Bhutatma. Kurvannapi na lipyate.
Take the meanings. Oh no, let's translate. The Karma Yogi, who has fully conquered his mind, mastered his senses, whose heart is pure, and who has identified himself with the self of all beings, that is God, remains untainted even though performing action. It's a beautiful shloka. I love it. Let's do the meanings. Yoga yukto, the one who is endowed with yoga, one who has mastered karma yoga, the one who has mastered doing action. Vishuddha atma, pure in mind, with a purified mind. Vijit atma, controlled in body. Body functions are controlled. Jitendriya, organs of perception are also conquered, conqueror of the senses. Sarva bhutatma bhutatma, the self of the self in all, the one who sees the self in all. Na lipyate, does not get tainted, does not get impure, does not get, actually the word lipyate meaning entangled, doesn't get caught up. Kurvannapi, even while performing actions. Normally we say, if you do action, you get karma. But this person, with all these whatever things we will talk about now, if he has all these attributes, qualities, even if he will do some action, he will not get karma for that action. So this is something for good for us, because we have to do action. So how should we be doing our actions so that we do not get karma for those actions? So the yoga yukta, the one who is an expert in karma yoga, the one who has perfected action in karma yoga, how will he be behaving? What will be his behavior? What will be his acharan? How will he be doing his actions? So four ways we have to see here, four ways. Bhagavan is giving us four lakshans in which you can recognize someone who is a yoga yukta, and more than that, you can take it as your own evaluation. Have I reached that stage of yoga yukta? One, Vishuddha atma, one whose mind is pure. Now don't get confused by the word atma. Vishuddha means pure, and atma, we normally take it as soul. So all souls are pure only. There is no soul which is not pure. So in Sanskrit, sometimes atma is used for soul. It's also used for body. Okay, it's also used for mind. So atma has many uses. So here it means mind. Here we are talking about pure mind. So what mind is pure? What kind of mind is a pure mind? Simply a mind which has no vasanas, desires. Because the desire or the vasana is the beginning of everything. It's also the beginning of your life. Vasana hai to janam hai. There is no vasana, there is no janam only. If there is no desire, there is no thought. If there is no thought, there is no action. So the beginning of everything is desire. So when that desire comes up, your mind is scattered, because it has an energy, and that energy is an energy which is almost impossible to control without good training. So the mind gets disturbed, the mind gets agitated, and very difficult, because you may have done lot of sadhana your whole life, and at the last moment, at the time of death, agar wo vasna has risen in your mind, your gati is spoiled. Means you will have to go to fulfill that vasna. So therefore, vasanas is very, very important. A desire-ridden mind. A desire-ridden mind can never be still. It will always be in movement. And if it cannot be still, it cannot contemplate on the truth. Manan kaise karoge? Dhyan kaise karoge? If there is desires continuously rising, impossible to keep the mind shant. And without shant mind, impossible to do dhyan. So it will be continuously restless. Continuously restless. But the yoga yukta, we are talking about yoga yukta, the one who has mastered, what has he done? Through the practice of karma yoga, he has learned to master his vasanas. So no longer he is seeking to do any selfish desire. He is not running after fulfilling any selfish desire. He has no desire. Yoga yukta has no desire. He has desire for others. No selfish desire. Without desire, you cannot do any action. You cannot get up also in the morning. If you don't have a desire to get up, it's not that desire is bad. It is the selfish personal desire which is causing the problem. And after having even that desire for helping others, he is dedicating that desire to Bhagwan. Bhagwan ke haath mein, samarpan bhav. Have you seen I had to ask Nikhil the name for that, snow globe.
Yes.
Huh?
Yes.
It's a round kind of a thing with a landscape inside, and you do like this, and it looks like snow is falling. And it's all, you cannot see clearly, and you keep it down. And when you keep that snow globe down, slowly, the snow comes down and you can see clearly. That's what we have to do with our vasanas. When the vasanas are agitated, you cannot see clearly. Your mind cannot be at peace. Therefore, you need to work on Vishuddh Atma. It's like a river, na? River is what? Water flowing. Mind is what? Thoughts flowing. Mind is nothing but a flow of thoughts. River is nothing but a flow of water. Now, the quality of the river depends on the quality of the water. Yes or no? We had to clean up the Ganga because we had made it so impure and dirty, right? The quality of your mind depends on the quality of your thoughts. The quality of your mind depends on the quantity of your thoughts. It depends also on the direction of your thoughts. Where is your thoughts going? Where are your thoughts going? And then, speed of your thoughts also. You take a dip in Haridwar, you have to hold something. Water is flowing so fast, right? You take a dip down further south, it's peaceful. So therefore, this mind also, you have to take care. What is the quality of my thought? What is the quantity of my thought? What is the speed of my thought? And what is the direction in which my thought is going? If you want to be yog yukta and you want to have Vishuddh Atma, then this is what you have to do. Not only is telling you what to do, but he's also telling you how to do. Next, Lakshan is Vijit Atma. Vijit Atma is controlled in body. So we thought of mind, now body. Here, body, Atma is standing for body, not soul. Vijit Atma, conqueror, controlled body. So the body moves in its organs of action, you know that, organs of action, tongue in terms of speech, then hands, legs, genitals, and organs of excretion. Now all these organs of the body have a memory of their own, and they have already formed habit of how to behave. Yes or no? Even the mind is shant, even the sense indriyas are not working or anything, what will happen? The organ of action will automatically, through habit, start moving. That is something you need to observe. Now, how am I going to make my atma, meaning here body, vijit? How am I going to control it? What is the sadhana? Satsang, of course, knowing what is vivek, what is my goal. Through vivek, you can control the organs of action. Once you know what is sat, what is asat, where is my goal, where is, what is taking me in the opposite direction of my goal. Once I know that, then I can use my organs of action to take me to my goal, rather than taking me away from my goal. So your organs of action have been given to you by Bhagwan, no? For a reason. So, but the reason, you have to use it correctly. So when we were doing up this center, so many carpenters were there, painters were there. All of them had some instruments, some hammer, some paintbrush, some saw, axe, God knows what all they had. All their instruments were there. So were they just going around everywhere with all their instruments in their hand, using all the instruments all the time? No. When they needed it, they picked up the hammer. When they didn't need the hammer, did they still hold it? They put it down. When they needed the paintbrush, they painted with it. When they didn't need the paintbrush, they put it down. When you need your organs of action, pick them up. If not, put them down. What does it mean? Where shall I put my hand down? Shall I put my tongue down? No, it means keep it away, keep it safely. And when will I need them? I will need them to take me to Bhagwan. Use your organs of action only when it's taking you to your goal. If it is taking you anywhere else, put it down, which means don't use it. Put it down. You don't need it. So vijit atma, vijit meaning victorious, be, have victory over your organs of action. Don't become the vanquished. Don't allow your organs of action to defeat you. You rise above them, vijit atma. Okay, next, third lakshan, jitendriya, jitendriya. Conqueror of your organs. Which organs? Sense organs. Indriya means organs of perception. Which are they? Eyes, nose, ears, tongue in terms of taste, and skin. Now these are the most dangerous ones, because mind is inside somewhere. You can go to sleep, or you can be involved with reading. It's easier. But the indriyas, they are the ones, they are like the hunters. They go out into the world and they capture images, they capture vishayas, and bring it back inside your antakaran. Kuch nahi karna padta hai. They are just directly going out and collecting attraction, collecting vishay, collecting pleasure, collecting happiness, collecting your whatever, Louis Vuitton and all that stuff. Okay, so the most important thing for you to first think about is, where are my sense organs running? Eyes, where are they running? Taste buds, where are they taking me? Golden dragon. Where are my ears going? Some head banging thing on the mobile phone. Where is my, you know, these are the things. If you want to be the conqueror of yourself, then these are the things you need to become aware of. And Bhagwan has given us the upay. Bhagwan has given us the solution. What to do with these sense organs who are running, darting without, and you know, see how wonderful. Even with my eyes closed, I'm not looking at anything, my eyes remember all the vishayas of the world. Even if they are not in front of me. Sitting here, I can, this organ, it's not the nose itself, it's the sense of smell, can remember the smell of that chocolate cake that Bhavna brought to Thakur Nivas one day. You know, like that. You don't have to have the vishay in front of you. This sense organ is such that it can bring all that input inside you, and it brings the entire sansar inside. It's the window of sansar for the antakaran. What to do? Become the tortoise. Chapter 2, Shlok 58. When the tortoise sees any danger in front of it that is taking it away from its goal, what does it do? It brings its head, its limbs, everything under the shell. Stays there in safety till the danger has passed. Which shell we go into? We don't have a shell. Atma. Bhagwan. When the vishay is there, which is taking our sense organs into the sansar, focus it on Bhagwan. These beautiful things. I mean, these are secrets of life. This should be taught in every school from the beginning. What we are learning at the age of 50 and 60 and 40 and 30, we have wasted 30, 40, 50, 60 years of life. This is what should be taught. And finally, fourth lakshan. Sarva bhutatma bhutatma. As we said earlier, what have we identified ourselves as? Body, mind, intellect. But the yoga yukta, the one who has mastered karma yoga, the one who has mastered himself, he is not identifying with BMI. He is identifying with self. And once you identify with the Atma, self in you, you identify with that self in all. You can never think separately, I and you. You know very clearly this Atma and that Atma, that word, that sentence only is wrong. Because there is no this Atma and that Atma. There is only one Atma, and that is the same one in each and every one of us. So generally we'll identify with our nationality, we'll identify with our name, we'll identify with I'm a mother, I'm a father, I'm a wife, I'm a husband, we'll identify with our profession, we'll even identify with our shape, I'm fat, I'm thin, I'm tall, I'm short. But none of these are your true attributes, because your true self is not any of these things. The yoga yukta has realized that. The yoga yukta says, "Ye kya hai? This is all false." And how foolish we are, see? How foolish we are. All these attributes, we say tall, short, Indian, American, mother, father, these are all false attributes. Right or wrong? illusion, right? So we compare our false attributes with the false attributes of others and we judge them. So one false attribute is judging another false attribute and condemning that person to be kharab, bad, this thing, that thing, judging. So it's as ridiculous as me sleeping in the night, I got a nice dream, I had such a beautiful dream. And Rajan says, I also had a very beautiful dream last night, you know. No, no, my dream is better than your dream. He said, no, my dream is better. Whose dream is better? No dream, because dream is not real. And we are arguing, my dream is better than your dream. My dream is bigger. I dreamt of a king. So I dreamt of emperor. But the king is also not real, and the emperor is also not real, and the dream is also not real. And what we are comparing and what we are fighting about. Hello? What are we fighting about? One person goes in the desert and sees one oasis. It's a mirage. It's not a real oasis. He sees something he thinks is an oasis. Someone said, I saw better oasis. My palm trees were taller and had more dates on them. He says, no, mine had mermaids. Okay. But both are false. So what are you fighting about? So, sarva bhutatma bhutatma. We are all atma. What are you fighting about? What are you comparing? What are you judging? The yoga yukta only sees atma jo yaha hai, wo vaha bhi hai, vaha bhi hai, vaha bhi hai, ek hai. Aisa bhi nahi ki my atma is better than your atma. That also cannot happen. And the very word my atma and your atma, that also is wrong. Because there is no my and there is no your in that. Sarva bhutatma bhutatma. Okay? Realize master knows only atma self is real. There is no two to compare also. There is no other. Alright? So when you have these four lakshans and don't start judging others again with all these four lakshans. These four lakshans are for you only to judge yourself. Where have I reached? What do I have to purify? Where do I have to go? What all do I have to do? When you will get all these four, kurvanapi na lipyate. Lipyate, I love that word lipyate. Na lipyate, na lipyate. One of the chapters, every time there are 5-6 verses are there, na lipyate. It will not entangle you into karma. It will not bring you back into sansar. Don't get bound even by performing actions. Aap kuch bhi karo nahi, sab kuch karo, kuch bhi karo nahi. Sab kuch karo, but do it correctly, no karma. No karma. Okay? So a yoga yukta is not one that has stopped doing any work. He does not stop performing actions. But he performs actions without any personal, selfish desire or benefit. Then why he does? Then why he does? For others. For the benefit of others. And he will work more also. He will work more also. He will work for the benefit of others to prevent them from going astray. Because he knows the joy. He has experienced that joy. How na? Walk on the path now, you'll also feel that joy. He wants others also to experience that joy. So he will walk very hard so that you don't go in the wrong gully. Just stay on the highway. Don't go into the gullies and get entangled in karma. Okay? He wants to liberate them. He wants to make them aware. Baba, ye avgun hai tere andar. Usko nikal. Take it out and start freeing yourself. That is why such a master will perform lots of actions. Whole time that person will be working. but for the benefit of others. Yoga Yukta. He will not get bound. He will not get tainted. And you know, this knower of truth, the Yoga Yukta, he knows very well this body is doing some actions. I am not the doer. I am not the one who is doing. And he really feels that way. No matter how frantically you will see this person working, maybe from day to night, maybe everyone will say, now take some rest, now stop working so hard, delegate to others. Why working so hard on 19th of July? Stop doing. The person doesn't feel they are doing anything. They know very well his body is doing. Why? For the benefit of others. Okay. So, you know now, for lakshans, you have, your path is clear. You know whether you need to do path of action or path of knowledge. When to do the path of action, when to do the path of renunciation. Everything is clear for you. How to judge where you are, how to move forward, that is also given to you. Sadhana is clear. What is the sadhana? Check four things. How pure is my mind? Meaning, how much vasana is still there? How many desires are still there? Two, vijitatma. How controlled are my organs of action? Am I just running around like a headless chicken, carrying out everything? How controlled are my organs of action? Jitendriya. How much victory do I have over my organs of perception? And Sarva Bhutatma Bhutatma. Have you stopped comparing your false self with the false self of others? You are comparing your false self with the false self of others. How foolish. First, you do that, you will become Yogyukta. That's all. It's so simple. Isn't it? I'm asking everyone on Zoom. So simple. Just do these four things. By next fortnight, you'll all be Yogyukta. Right? Then you can go on to Gyan Yoga. For Sarva Bhutatma Bhutatma. Have you stopped comparing your false self with the false self of others? Means, have you stopped telling people my dream is better than your dream? My oasis is much better. It has beautiful mermaids. Right? So simple. Life is simple. Actually, it is quite simple. Only we are not using things correctly. That's all. Enough for today. Let's say the prayer.
Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate Om Shanti 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 Hari Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha Hari Om.
Jai Gurudev.